hey, let me transition into our series today, because I am really stoked about changing gears. Now we're entering into a new season where Easter is just 8 weeks away. You know, this is a 7-week series that we're going to be doing, the last words of Jesus for 7 weeks. We are going to look at the 7 final statements that Jesus made on the cross. And a lot of you may not know that's how many he actually had, 7 statements. And you have to go to all 4 Gospels to get all the statements that Jesus said on the cross. But these were his final words. And what I love about this, you guys, is even in his most difficult day, which we call it Good Friday. You guys know there was nothing good about that day for him. Like, Jesus would not have called that day good. He would have called this was. Let's understand this, what we're talking about here, and where we're going to be. We're going to be looking to the cross for 7 weeks together. We're going to be looking to the cross. This was Jesus' worst day ever. It was his most painful day. It was his most difficult day. It was a day he dreaded. He literally dreaded. He was in the Garden of Gethsemane. How many remember that? Where he's praying, God, let this cup pass from me. He's sweating blood, stressed and distressed about this most painful day that he has anticipated for thousands of years. He is the pre-existing eternal one. This is all culminating. He knew it from the beginning of the foundation of the world. And still, when it was at his door, he was afraid, his human part of him. It was his worst day ever. This is what I love about this is even in his worst day, he's still teaching us. He's still speaking wisdom and life. And here's the context of this series. I want us to, Jesus endured this final day, his worst day ever. And I want us to learn how we can endure our worst day. Like based upon what he said and how he handled it, we're going to learn how to go through our painful days, the worst days that we will experience. We're going to learn how Jesus did it, and we're going to apply it to our bad days, because we got some bad days. Some of you are maybe in a bad season right now. Jesus has life for you. He has wisdom for you. You can endure. But here's the thing is, you know, we like the resurrection part. Yeah, we're going to resurrect. And listen, in order for God to resurrect some of those pains, some of those hurts, some of those wounds that maybe you're carrying still today coming in here with, in order for there to be a resurrection and for redemption, for those things to be redeemed, I'm telling you, you need to follow Jesus' way, the pattern Jesus did it. Or else, if you don't follow his pattern, the way Jesus dealt and endured with those wounds and the pains we're going to talk about, you'll carry those to your grave. You won't get the redemption part of it. You got to learn how Jesus did it. And so that's what we'll do. 7 weeks, we're going to look at the cross and see what Jesus has to teach us. And I know that even this series is about, yeah, you're going to have a bad day. And how do you prepare for that? And I know that's kind of a bummer. You wish I would say it's going to be great from here. But the Bible never promises that you'll never have a bad day, you guys. It's coming. You're going to have some bad days, and some of you are in a bad day or bad season. So let's learn how to handle them when they do come. Let's open up your notes. If you have some message notes, you take those out, or your Bibles. We got our message note binders. We have some of those in, and so those are, if you are new to Discovery, you can grab one of those at the next step, at the information center. Grab one of those. The first one's free. Next one's $4. Okay, so we used to just give them all away free, but then, you know, people grabbing like 10 of them, like, nah, come on now. Okay, so Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2 says, I love having a lot of my series we'll have around here a theme verse. Hebrews 12 and 2 is where we're gonna stick to, and this is gonna be our theme verse for the next 7 weeks. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. And I don't want you to miss this next line, it's so key. Who for the joy set before him endured the cross. You see, in other words, the way Jesus handled his worst day is he didn't focus on that day. He didn't focus on that day. He was focused on another day. There was another day down the road. There was a joy down the road. There was a joy that was set before him, and he was able to endure that most painful day. He was able to endure the worst day of his life because he wasn't focused on that day, that there was an eternal prize waiting him. That's how he handled his worst day. scorning the shame, and sat down at the right hand of God, or right hand of the throne of God. And that's where Jesus is, by the way, right now. He's at the right hand of God. The Bible says that he is constantly, forever making intercession for the saints. If you want to know what Jesus is doing right now, he's praying for you. That's what he's doing. He's praying for the church. I love this. Let me read it now in the Message translation. That's what you actually have in the notes. Hebrews 12 and 2. I like the way it puts it. It says, keep your eyes on Jesus, who both began and finished this race we're in. And I love this little phrase. Study how he did it. And that's what we're going to do. For 7 weeks, you guys, we're going to study how he handled his worst day, because he never lost sight of where he was headed, that exhilarating finish in and with God. He could put up with anything along the way, the cross, shame, whatever, and now he's there in the place of honor right alongside God. So we're going to study how he did it. You know, when I think of and I see people that are holding on to unforgiveness and bitterness, which is the first principle, the first words that Jesus say on the cross. Look, they nailed him. They picked the cross up. The first words out of Jesus' mouth, I believe there's something called the order of priority, the importance of the first things in Scripture. When something is mentioned first, it means there's importance because of it. And this is the first words that Jesus spoke as they resurrected the cross. Let me say it this way, that this was the first thing Jesus had to deal with in his own heart. That's why he had to speak it. It was the very first thing that came out of Jesus' mouth. This is it. Luke chapter 23, 34. Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing. I know they just drove the nails into my hands. I know they just slapped me, spit on me, beat me, ripped, pulled out my beard. I know they just did those things, but God, he somehow in the middle of that, he redirected his feelings. He redirected his emotions off of those people who were abusing him, and he was able to redirect them somewhere else. You see, forgiveness is an act of the will, not your feelings. Do you know that? So forgiveness is you can act out of your will, and it doesn't matter the temperature of your heart. It doesn't matter what you're feeling. You can choose to forgive, and that's what Jesus is teaching us. He's teaching us this first life lesson, this first thing that you and I need to do on our worst day, on the day of your pain, on the day of your struggle, when it hits you, and when you're attacked or what, on your painful days, this is the first thing that you and I are to do. Remember, it's the first thing. It's not something you're supposed to do years after. It's not something you're supposed to do years down the road. You're in a discovery group now, and you've been holding on to this bitterness for so long, and now it just comes out with tears and baggage, and no. No, this is the first thing Jesus teaches us we're to do in our painful day. Write it down this way. Forgive everyone who's trying to hurt you. Forgive everyone who's trying to hurt you. Now, I word it that way, trying to hurt you, because it seems like that a lot of times, right? It seems like people are just out to get you. Even sometimes, obviously they're not. Sometimes it's unintentional. But man, it just seems like people just woke up with their mission in life today was to ruin your day, right? You work with some of those people, you know, sit next to some of those people. No, I'm just kidding. Don't raise your hand for that one. But man, when I see, you know, people that I've been doing ministry for a long time, I see people that are carrying the baggage of not just the thing, not just the past, but of the bitterness. They carry the bitterness and the unforgiveness with them. It's sad. It reminds me of the wide load truck on the freeway. Have you ever got stuck behind that guy? Right? You're on the freeway, and it's this little bitty truck in the front. He's just barely going like 45 miles an hour. He's trying to pull that thing, and it's got this big old gigantic load. It's a house. It's some sort of rig. It's something. It even has this like wide load on it. It's taking up the two lanes. You can't get around that thing. And it's got some red flags in the back. Wide load. And this is what I think of when I think of people that are carrying the load of unforgiveness and bitterness. They're just, you can't get behind me. I'll take you out. You know, don't you see? I'm carrying a load here. Don't you see? And I see this, it's slowing you down. It's preventing you from fulfilling your purpose. It's messing with your journey. It's messing up everybody on the road with you. that oversized load. What do we do? What do we do with all that? We're gonna look, just because you were hurt doesn't mean you got to live with it. You don't have to live with that hurt. And I understand it's part of your story. It's part of your experience. And so you may be thinking like, well, it is what it is. That's what I went through. Look, just because you were hurt does not mean you have to live with that hurt. You can release that. You can redeem that hurt. And the way you do that is through forgiveness. That's the way you redeem the hurts. You redeem the most painful days of your life. You redeem it through forgiveness. I thought it would be good with starting with answering the question, where does it come from? Where does unforgiveness? Where does the bitterness? Where are the loading zones in our life that maybe we can get tempted to just load on and just go down the road and just kind of pack it all on? There are some loading zones that I want to kind of identify with you. And the way I came up with these sources of unforgiveness is I just followed Jesus' day. It started around 9 p.m. on Thursday, and then they crucified him 9 a.m. Friday, and about 3 p.m. that day, he gave his last breath. And so what I did is I just looked at Jesus' final day and what he had to go through, what he went through, and these sources of really these loading zones that could have potentially, you know, packed on Jesus' shoulders and gave him just a bitter spirit. He had a few loading zones. I want to go over some of those with you, because maybe as we're going over these, I want you to see if you can relate to any of these loading zones. See if any of these are something that maybe you're carrying around today. Here's the first source of unforgiveness that Jesus had to deal with, and that is betrayal. Betrayal. It's not enough just to be killed. No, he was handed over to the authorities by his buddy, by his friend. I mean, it may be that this could have hurt more than the nails in the hands. Because if you've ever been betrayed by a friend, by someone you love, somebody you were counting on, a marriage, a child, a parent, someone who you thought, dude, you're supposed to be on my side. What happened? And all of a sudden they let you down. I would say a lot of times the pain of the heart can be a lot more painful than the physical pain we endure in our life. You have to suffer the betrayal. Maybe some of you are familiar with that. Maybe that's a loading zone for you in your story. The second thing Jesus had to deal with, the source of unforgiveness, is false accusation. False accusation. You ever been through that? This is really a bummer, because it's like people are dogging you. They're saying things about you, and they don't even got the right facts. They don't have, you know, they got the facts all wrong. They don't have it right, and now you're being accused of stuff you didn't even do. And if there's a loading zone for me in my life, you guys, I mean, this is one. This is a loading zone for me, because anyone who's a leader in here, you're out front. You're an easy target. You're a target for the enemy. You're a target for people. And so I've gotten a lot of arrows shot at me being a leader over the years, especially over the last 3 years, you know, since starting Discovery Church. Because what God has done here at Discovery has been nothing short of a miracle, you guys. We've just seen some crazy growth, souls being saved, doors open that no man could open. But some people, even colleagues of mine, you know, some co-laborers of mine, they'll look at what's happening and I have to hear some things like, man, that can't be right. That can't be right. They must be doing something wrong over there, you know, because the church just doesn't grow like that. They must be doing something wrong, because God forbid, if you just teach the Bible and love people, it will grow a church. Come on now, somebody. And so I've had to. This has been a loading zone, a potential loading zone for me that I have to identify and say, no, I'm not going to hold on to that. No, these false, you know, accusations. Can I tell you, someone else's success does not equal your failure. All right, someone else, it doesn't equal your failure. And a lot of times people get into this whole false accusation stuff because they're comparing their life and their journey with someone else's. And anytime you start doing that, you're going to fall into some of those insecure traps, those traps of insecurity. And you know, that's one of the things Jesus had to deal with, this false accusation. They were accusing him falsely. And how about this one, this third one, rejection. Because here they are, the trial of Jesus, and there's false accusations. Like, he didn't do what they were saying. They actually had people testify and give witness against him. And you would think that on that day, someone, at least one person for Jesus would stand up and go, hey, can I want to put my testimony in the record here. This is the Jesus I know. No. And not one person to his defense. Actually, he was rejected by all but one. And Peter rejected him royally, didn't he? He denied him three times in the hour, in the moment he needed a friend the most. Peter denies him. I don't know if you've been rejected before. And now you're carrying you're carrying it around down the road. It's just a loading zone for some of us, rejection. Here's the fourth one. Write this one down. Abuse. Because once he was tried and found guilty, even though he wasn't guilty, he was found guilty. They accused him, falsely accused him guilty. He goes on through several beatings. We've all seen the movies, and the movies are bad enough, but they don't even do it justice of the actual beatings. Because he went through several rounds. He went through Pilate's guys and Herod's guys, and they had weapons and sticks and beating his body and his head, smashing him around, blindfolding him, socking him, slapping him, spitting on him, saying, guess who hit you now? Prophesy, prophet. Hit him and prophesy who hit you if you're a prophet. And just the abuse that he endured. They ripped out his beard right off his face. The Bible says he was marred beyond recognition. That the people that would look on him would not even recognize that can't be Jesus of Nazareth. No way. He was just so marred, so beat up. There was, in this moment in history, capital punishment was at its worst in all of history, which I think was intentional. Obviously, it was intentional. I mean, God doesn't, he did that on purpose. Can you imagine that? Because Jesus, again, he's the pre-existent eternal one. So in the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth, Jesus was there. He was there. The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, they were all there. They were existing. So I have to imagine there was a conversation that took place at some point. Hey, when are we going to go pay for the sins of the people? When are we going to go pay? And the Father and God looks down because, he's just looking at the whole timeline and goes, Right there. Where capital punishment is at its worst. That's where I want you to go. I mean, if you were to come today, lethal injection would be, I mean, it's still bad, but it's nothing like what Jesus had to endure. Abuse at the highest level. He went through it so much. And some of you have felt this pain. You've gone through emotional abuse, physical abuse, maybe some people that you've loved or parents, the way they treated you, other family members. Some of you, you're abused by your boss or your supervisor. You have to work in a place of abuse and you carry that. And it's easy just to take that wound and it's a loading zone. Here's the last one. And this one I think is terrible as well. And that is humiliation. Humiliation. And I hate this one. I hate for someone to embarrass someone else in front of people. You know, like to clown them or someone because they're different or they look different or they talk different or they're perceived as weaker. So someone, some insecure jerk, you know, I hate that. I just tell you, I hate that. It's just, I can't stand when people embarrass other people purposefully to put them down. It's wrong. And you will never see this depicted in the movies, rightly so. You will never see the real nature of the crucifixion because history tells us that when people are crucified, they're crucified buck naked. In which it wrenches my stomach, you guys, to think about my Lord, my Savior, my King Jesus, just humiliated, nailed to a cross. And it's easy to have these loading zones. It's easy to get loaded up and just have this junk going on in our lives. And again, let me just tell you, it was important for Jesus to go to the cross, to suffer, to pay for your sins. But that's not all. That's not the only reason why he was there. That's not the only reason why Jesus went to the cross and endured that pain. He intentionally, systematically went through these hours of torture and hurt at so many different levels so that he could possibly experience, so that he could come alongside of you in your worst day. so that he would qualify to come along your side and say, I've been there and I understand. He went through everything he endured, all the abuse, all the shame, all the humiliation, all the torture for you. Look, that's what the scripture says, Hebrews chapter 2, verse 17 and 18. It says, that's why Jesus, he had to enter every detail of human life. There was nothing left out that Jesus experienced. There was every detail. Then when he came before God as high priest to get rid of the people's sin, he would have already experienced it all. Everything that you go through himself. All the pain, all the testing. Why? So that he would be able to help you when you needed the help. That's why he did it. Not just to pay for your sins, but so he could help you in your most painful days. You know, I love that. You know what that means? It means Jesus qualifies to be your best friend. He qualifies to be your best friend. He knows what it's like. He knows what you're going through. And I'm speaking about forgiveness a lot over the years. And every time I speak about it, I feel the tension in the room. I can feel it because it's hard. This is a hard thing to forgive in the manner and the way that God does tell us to forgive. And because there's always the, you know, I understand what you're saying, Pastor, but you're making it sound so easy. You don't know what I've been through. You don't know what I've experienced. And there's that tension. I want you to know I understand the pain. I understand what you are feeling and what you're maybe even thinking right now. And I want to tell you maybe before I get into how you can walk in forgiveness and to study how Jesus did it and apply it to your life, I want to tell you what I'm not talking about. Can I tell you that for a moment? Can I tell you what forgiveness is not? Because I think there is some confusion here. Write down these three things. This is what forgiveness is not. This is not what I'm telling you to do, and I'm not suggesting you to do. Number one, forgiveness is not minimizing the seriousness of the offense. Forgiveness is not minimizing. I'm not saying, oh, get over it. You shouldn't be holding on. Why are you holding on to that? It's been years. Let it go already. I know it hurt. I'm not saying it didn't hurt. I'm not saying it wasn't wrong. I'm not saying it wasn't painful. I'm not minimizing the seriousness of it was bad. It was a terrible thing. It was unjust. I understand that. I'm not minimizing the seriousness of the offense. And secondly, I'm not asking you to have an instant restoration of trust. No one here will tell you, okay, just go back to that man and let him do it all over. Just let him do it again. Let him do it again to you. That's not what I'm saying. No one here is going to try to give you that advice. No one's asking you to trust that person. Now, I will say this. You are obligated to forgive that person. You're obligated to forgive that person, but you're not obligated to trust them. There's a difference between forgiveness and trust. There needs to be a lot of times restitution. I'm not saying, here's the third thing, because I'm not also saying that relationship should even be resumed at all, or at least not resumed without changes. Resuming the relationship without changes, because if there is a restoration of a marriage, if there is going to be reconciliation, which we advocate for that to be reconciled, you guys, there needs to be true repentance on both parts in order for that to happen. There needs to be true repentance. There needs to be restitution. And there also needs to be a rebuilding of trust. So let's just be very clear. What I'm asking you, what the scriptures are asking you to do is more of a condition of your heart. That's what we're talking about, the condition of your heart. And remember, the theme of this message series is we're going to study how Jesus did it. So the question is, how did Jesus forgive? Like on his worst day, with everything that he did endure and had to experience, like how did Jesus forgive? And the scriptures are filled with ways that you can be someone who walks in forgiveness and who forgives others, and I want to give you those today. And I honestly believe that if you apply these to your life, if you apply these principles to your life, this has the power to change your life, I'm telling you, if you will apply these truths. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 23, says that when Jesus suffered, here's the example we have, the example Jesus has for us. When he suffered, he did not threaten to get even. He left his case in the hands of God. So, If you take this route, and I hope you do, I hope you take the way Jesus did it. I hope you take this route. Let me tell you, if you do, you will be set free. You'll get rid of the load. You'll get rid of the burden. You'll get rid of the stuff that you've been carrying around. You will be set free. But that doesn't mean that it's gone. That doesn't mean that it's erased. No. It just means that you're not going to deal with it. I didn't have room enough in the scriptures to put it, but there's a scripture in Romans chapter 12 that says that it actually says leave room for the wrath of God. Like give that painful thing, give that hurtful experience, give that to God. And what you're doing in doing that, you're leaving room for God to judge. You're leaving room for God to avenge the wrath of God. So what your forgiveness is just saying, look, I'm not going to be the one to do it. I'm not going to be the one to take control and to get avenge or revenge. I'm not going to hold on to this. It's not mine to hold on to. You see, forgiveness isn't about you and that other person. Forgiveness is about you and God. That's what it's about. Four principles, you guys, that you need to know in order to be someone who can walk in forgiveness. And honestly, this first one, this could be a one-point message for me. This is a one and done. For me, this is it. You know, it's just a one-point message, and this is it. I'm not going to give you just one point, but I could have. Here it is. Forgive them because I need forgiveness too. That's it. That's all I need. I need that. I need some more forgiveness. I cannot prevent the flow of forgiveness to ever stop coming to me, man, because I still mess up. I still need to be forgiven. I know maybe you don't like your pastor to say that, but I'm just being honest with you. I still need it. I haven't found the secret to a perfect life. If you have, let me know. Talk to me, okay? I haven't found that secret. I still need forgiveness. And the Bible is very clear on this in multiple occasions that it talks about that if you do not forgive others, then God's not going to forgive you. Here's one of those occasions, Matthew 6:15. For if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. Now, I don't know about you, but I can't afford that. I just can't. I can't afford the forgiveness flow to stop. Some people say, well, I will never forgive. I can never forgive that when they did when I was a kid or when that person, I can never. Well, I hope you never sin again. I hope you never sin because you're stopping the forgiveness flow. If that's the statement, if that's not the route you can go. If you want to do it God's way, you can't go that route, you guys. So if you find yourself thinking, man, they hurt me so much, I will never forgive them. Man, I'm telling you, you need to forgive them because you need it too. Forgive them because I need forgiveness too. That's why Jesus said, hey, yeah, you can stone that girl. You can stone her, but who's without sin, cast the first stone. So what he's saying is like, look, none of you are perfect. None of you, all of you have sin. So if you're going to throw a stone at her, might as well just throw one at yourself as well. Everybody gets stoned today. Not that kind of stone. Some of you are like, yeah. This is my kind of church. Stop it. If you want to study that further, Matthew chapter 18. Go study Matthew chapter 18. To me, it's one and done. I don't need any more, Jesus. That's it. I'm okay, but I'm going to give you three more just because I have a few more minutes. No, I'm kidding. Here's you go. You want to be a person of forgiveness, then we need to forgive them without condition. We need to forgive them without condition because we'll get those, okay, pastor, I'll forgive them if they do it first. I'll say I'm sorry if they call me. No, they haven't called me. They haven't come and said sorry to me. And so we'll get this little if then. Like if they say sorry, then I'll say sorry. Look, you can't go that route. Look again. Okay, you can't go that route if you want to do it the way Jesus did it. And if you want that resurrection thing that happened, if you want to be redeemed, if you want that hurt, that pain, that difficulty, if you want that to be redeemed, then you need to do it the way Jesus did it. And this is the way Jesus did it. Ephesians chapter 4. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, and then it tells you how. Forgiving each other just as in Christ God forgave you. And let me just tell you how he did it, okay? When they were nailing Jesus to the cross, and those centurions got the nail, and they're about to drive the hammer in. Jesus didn't go, wait. Let me, 1 minute. Is anyone going to receive this? Is anyone going to, because I'm not going to go through with it. What's the use of going through with it? None of you are going to receive. No, he didn't do that. The Bible actually says that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, which means that he did it without condition. He forgave, like he He has forgiven you all. He's forgiven the entire world. It's unconditional. The debt is paid. You can have it if you want it. I'm doing it anyway. That's the forgiveness that God offers. We're to forgive without condition. And so when you forgive that way that He did us, and that is, you don't wait for, He didn't wait for us, He did it ahead of time. When you do that, it gives power. I'm telling you, it'll give power to your forgiveness, which leads into step number three, or the third way that you can be a person of forgiveness, which really, this is the secret sauce. This is the trade secret of being someone who walks in forgiveness. Write it down. This is so important. Forgive them in advance. Forgive them in advance. I mean, forgive them before they hurt you. You know why? Because they're going to hurt you. Okay? Pastor, can't you be a little bit more positive? I'm positive they're going to hurt you. Okay? And I'm not doom and glooming over all of your relationships. And I'm not trying to say you got to be pessimistic of all your relationships. It's going to be all pain. That's not what I'm saying. What I am saying is that you enter into those relationships expecting they're going to have a bad day too. You know, they have hurts and issues, and they sometimes are not going to meet all of my expectations. I'm going to leave room for them. And so in advance, before they even hurt me, I'm just going to forgive them anyway. I'm just going to choose that. I'm going to forgive before. That's actually what Jesus said in the Lord's Prayer that He gave us. That's the whole reason for praying this prayer. Luke 11 and 4, that part of that prayer says, "Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us." And here's the point of that prayer. It's supposed to be prayed every day. Like whether they hurt you or not, you're supposed to pray that prayer. God, forgive me, and I'm going to forgive those who sin against me. Because the whole point, you guys, is of that prayer is not for you to be reactive, but for you to be proactive in your forgiveness. It's a preemptive strike against the enemy, because the devil would love to keep you loaded up, just going 40 miles an hour. Look, it's slowing you down. It's preventing you from getting off on certain exits. It's preventing you from even fitting in some places, because this wide load that you're carrying around, the enemy would love for you to just be loaded up. I'm telling you, this preemptive strike, it's a weapon of warfare for the child of God, forgiveness. See, the weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. We fight with different weapons, and this weapon of forgiveness just will free you. It'll set you free. We forgive those as we forgive those who sin against us. This is going to bring so much freedom. Because when you do that, when you say, look, I'm going to forgive them in advance, and then it does happen, and then you do get hurt, it stings a whole lot less. Now, it still stings. I'm not saying it doesn't hurt. It's still going to sting. It just stings a whole lot less than you just unexpectedly like, oh no, I didn't expect for that to happen today. Now my day is terrible. Now it's falling apart. Because ultimately, you guys, hurting people are going to hurt people. And the world is full of hurting people. And they've been through storms and challenges, and they've experienced some wounds, and they haven't done what we're talking about today. They didn't have an offload. And so they're carrying that around and passing it around to everyone. And that leads to the fourth thing here, which is so important. If you want to be a person of forgiveness, write it down this way. Forgive them because they're victims too. See, when you can see beyond the hurt, beyond the person even, and see that they have been a victim too, that they're just repeating the same mistakes. They're just rude because someone was rude to them. They're just angry because someone was angry at them. They're just frustrated because they've experienced frustration. I'm telling you, that's why we got to redirect our emotions, you guys, because you're not fighting against flesh and blood. That's that next scripture, last scripture, Ephesians 6:12. Our struggle is not against that person that you're holding a grudge against, that you're bitter about. Your grudge is not against your father or your mother or your that relative. That's not your grudge is not against your boss, your coworker, whatever loading zones that you have. Your grudge is not against those flesh and blood things. You got to see beyond that. I'm telling you, if you want to be a person that walks in forgiveness, you need to put on the eyes of Christ. See beyond that person and see the hurt, to see that they're a victim too. And that the only reason why they're hurting you is because that's what they love. That's what they know. That's all they know. And hurting people hurt people. You got to look past that person. Somebody hurt them and redirect your energy and your passion. Look, love people. Hate the devil. Love people. And hate the enemy. Redirect your enemy to the struggle is not against the flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. You want to be a person that walks in forgiveness? Redirect your emotions towards your real enemy. Come on, let's bow our heads, church.